Welcome to Rune Soup, a podcast about magic, culture, and the paranormal. Coming to you from... My name is Gordon, and I shall be your host. Enjoy. Today on Rune Soup, we are speaking to author, podcaster, and fellow Bruno nerd, Scott Gosnell, about what else but Bruno himself. Scott, thank you very much for your time.
It's a pleasure to be here.
All right, well, Mr. Gosnell, you know the drill by now. Were you a weird kid?
I used to think that I was a weird kid, but the older I get, the more I think that everyone was a weird kid. You know, it used to be more of a thing if you were sort of into pop culture and maybe played Dungeons and Dragons and you were a little bit nerdy and non-sporty that you felt like a weird kid. But, you know, now everyone remembers that as their childhood.
You know who's weird now? Jocks.
Jocks are weird too.
And well, they are now because they're the minority. So everyone, you know, everyone does identify, as you say, with the kind of weird spectrum. And so if you're a kid today who's like, do you know what? I actually just like baseball. That's my thing. Or yeah, whatever. They're the weirdo.
That's right. You go, how bizarre. Baseball. A 19th century sport. It's very steampunk. Right?
Yeah. So, but what you're saying is you had a similar kind of interest in the tends to happen to a lot of our guests, interest in that sort of, you know, maybe comics, maybe that kind of thing.
Right. So I was big into comics. I was big into kind of these Fortean things. I was into all of the, like, 70s. I don't know how to describe it. But in America, there's a TV series that was called In Search Of that was narrated by Leonard Nimoy. And, you know, they would do things like the Loch Ness Monster or Ancient Aliens or Bigfoot or something like that. And because it was Leonard Nimoy, you would sort of say, well, you know, he's Vulcan. So, you know, and he would say, like, could this be a picture of the Loch Ness Monster? And they'd put up some big pixelated thing that was completely out of focus and in two shades of gray. And you'd go, well, I don't know. It could be anything. It could be, you know, your great aunt Gertrude. But it's certainly possible that, you know, this guy who plays Vulcan on TV knows what he's talking about.
Yeah, he's all logic, you know. Surely he's not going to lie about the Loch Ness Monster.
Right, and he had this very kind of smooth way of talking. But there were all of these things that were kind of floating in the air in the 70s when I was, in my, not even teens, but in my 0 to 10 phase. And, you know, read a lot of science fiction, a lot of fantasy.
And you know, stand out, like what was your book and what was your comic?
Well, it's fantasy is a weird thing because it's all additive and multiplicative. So you always start with something like Tolkien, where, you know, or C.S. Lewis, where you're, you know, those are kind of the classic first alternative worlds that you look at. And then I kind of built out from there. So, you know, I have like 5,000, 10,000 paperbacks, you know, sitting in my old bedroom at home that are, you know, various fantasy and science fiction series. So
how do your parents feel about, you know, you leaving all your junk there?
Oh, they love it. They love it, you know.
Yeah, fantasy's like that. It's almost monist. So Middle Earth is the sort of prime mover, and it kind of emanates the rest of it.
Right. And it's one of those things where, you know, if you look at the history of fantasy literature, the early stuff is not as weird as the later stuff. So if you are someone who is just coming in fresh to it, you know, it takes you a while to build up to the big and really bizarre and off the wall fantasy series. Right. Otherwise, you just don't know how to read them.
Yeah, you know, absolutely.
Right. And now it's more true that you have, you know, a lot of people, big blockbuster movies that have all kinds of special effects and things. But you still have a history where you're able to read those movies because you've seen all of the other movies that have come along before. Right. You don't have to go back to the 1950s where people are like, this is what a spaceship looks like. We're going to the other planet. And there would be a big build-up, and, you know, you would see one one creature in front of what was clearly a painted set, right? And you, so as the budget has improved and as the number of movies that people will have seen in the genre increase, you end up with a lot of flexibility in how you think about them. And you end up being able to read some very sophisticated and very kind of what used to be in jokes and are now, you know, completely understandable to most people in the culture.
Yeah, absolutely. So presumably that means, given the sort of course your life took, that there was a particular aesthetic that that stuck with you and kind of influenced, where you would go academically and that kind of thing.
Right. Well, academically, I went sort of I became very interested in psychology and eventually was going to be a writer and, you know, was also thinking I might do psychotherapy or something like that for profession, and then ended up not being able to get into the classes that I wanted to in the English department at Kenyon, which is very kind of English literature oriented, and switched over one of my majors to economics. And so from there, I ended up branching off into two different directions. And one of them was kind of in the psychology and neuroscience thing and did the better part of a PhD in neuroscience and related topics. And then years later, went back and studied and got an MBA. And so I became interested in all of the economic side of life.
Gotcha. So the Bruno stuff is a personal thing?
So, the Bruno stuff is a personal thing. Part of it is the psychology of it.
Yeah, sure.
I also happened to take a really great seminar my freshman year in college, which was on Faust and Faust legends. And one of the sort of side topics was Hermeticism and Neoplatonism in the Renaissance. And so it looked at how the ideas about magic had changed from the medieval era when, you know, it was kind of all witches and demons and that sort of thing, and became much more of an academic and, I don't know, system of the world, I would say.
The emergence of natural philosophy as an idea in the Renaissance.
Yeah, exactly. So magic was then seen as the extension of, you know, natural phenomena. And one of the people... So we didn't actually deal with Bruno at all in the course, but we did deal with people like Pico della Mirandola and John Dee and the usual suspects.
Well, you probably at that stage would have encountered the dame, and if you encountered her, you end up at Bruno at some stage.
Yes, so eventually off of that, I ended up encountering Francis Yates, Dame Francis Yates, who had some pretty remarkable ideas and knew how to write a good academic book that would entertain you and keep you turning pages. And also, I ran into Bruno through some other writers, a guy named John Crowley, who wrote a series of fiction books that were at one level about people living in the 1970s and 80s in upstate New York. And at another strand of it was people living in Bruno's time. And in fact, Bruno is a character in it.
The Egypt series. That's highly recommended.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a really good book for your listeners to get into, a really good series for your listeners to get into. Among the other things that it does, it very well captures the kind of magical dream time that is childhood.
That
folds over into your adulthood. And then also it does a really good way of describing the disenchantment that you get with whatever it is that you've chosen to do as a grown-up.
Yeah, it is. And speaking of Bruno, he kind of, I'm pretty sure it's in the first maybe even 10, 20 pages of the first book when Bruno's a child in Nola, And Crowley's book, or Crowley, that one's different Crowley, just breathed life into him. I'd never really pictured Bruno as a kid on a hill in Nola. And I found that quite, I could kind of, you could see that John Crowley had thought about Bruno as not just as a man, but as a person. And I really, that image of him on the hill has stuck with me.
Yeah, I would say that Crowley's Bruno is my favorite Bruno.
Yeah, well, one of the real things, one was probably a difficult person to be around, so yes.
Yeah, so the thing about doing Bruno studies or in working with other people who study Bruno is that you get people with very strong opinions and a very strong construction of who Bruno actually was. So you have the John Bossy, Bruno was a spy for Walsingham in Elizabethan England, which has no real evidence outside of that book, which is the Giordano Bruno and the Embassy Affair.
I wouldn't say, yeah, it's a bold claim.
It's precious little evidence.
So I think Bruno was a spy for Bruno. But we'll get to that. I think there was a lot of that going on with the sort of 150-year Hermetic underground. But we'll get onto that because, interestingly, you said Bruno kind of there's a different Bruno for every person in Brunology. So, Scott, I'll ask you, Giordano Bruno, who dat?
Well, Giordano Bruno, the version of him that I give is that he was a Dominican friar who, in his late 20s, early 30s, got pitched out of the convent where he was being educated for various deviations from Catholic dogma and custom at the time. So,
well, he was reading the Catholic equivalent of pornography on the toilet.
Yes, he was also reading Erasmus on the toilet, which really got him in trouble. Although Erasmus himself didn't get in all that much trouble, Bruno was found to have at least Erasmus and probably some other things that he was reading while on the John. And one of the components of my version of Bruno is that he was one of these people who was an inveterate reader. So A, he was a weird kid too, but B, he was one of those people who, if there was nothing else to read that he hadn't read, he would be, you know, reading the cereal boxes and, you know, the racing form or something. But he was an inveterate reader, was a thinker in ways that were more syncretic than a lot of people were comfortable with at the time, in big and small ways. He was an astronomy professor. So if you think of, like, your cool math teacher or your cool physics professor, that's kind of who he was. There's a lot of argument over how much of a scientist he was, how much of a magician he was, how much of a whatever. You're fairly safe if you say he was a philosopher.
It hinges on modern definitions of science and magic, and they both get very strawman very quickly. So yes. We'll talk about that. I like the kind of cool maths or cool physics teacher image, but for me, if I was to find someone alive and prominent today who has the closest personality match for Bruno for me, it would be Nassim Taleb, who obviously wrote The Black Swan, because he's extremely brilliant and has no filter in demonstrating has no filter in dealing with other people who are at variance with how he sees the world. And it's also quite funny because when he was still with the Dominicans, the reason they were sort of looking behind effectively the toilet for his forbidden pornography is because he'd already started to take the images of saints down from his cell because he's like, this stuff is all idiotic. And you could tell that he's in there going, this is not correct. This stuff you're all doing is silly. And he doesn't have the filter of going, yeah, it is silly, but they can kill you. So maybe go gently, gently. And there's all these little pieces that demonstrate. For me, I get that very Nassim Taleb on Twitter. You wouldn't need a fake Bruno account on Twitter. You can just follow Nassim Taleb.
That's right. That's who I usually describe as being the modern equivalent, is that he fought with everyone. Now, at the same time, there were a number of people who really, really liked him. And he was supposed to be very good company at the dinner table, very witty, very charming in person. But in his professional life, you know, he fought with the faculty of Oxford and with every other group of academics that he could run into. He fought with the church. He fought with them so much that he was the only person I know of who was actually excommunicated by three different churches or denominations. So he was first excommunicated by the Catholic Church. Then at one point he flees to Geneva, and he's hanging out there, and he says, oh, this is really cool, but I don't want to become a Calvinist because it's rather grim. And so they excommunicate him.
Almost in advance. Like, he hadn't joined them.
He hadn't joined the church, but they excommunicated him anyway.
Yeah.
And then
which is impressive
later,
in its own right. It's like, yeah, you haven't asked yet, but you definitively cannot join us.
Right. And then the third time is later in his life. He gets excommunicated because he gets in a fight with the Lutheran bishop of the town that he's living in. And that guy says, oh, well, you're right out. You know, you're gone. And so he's excommunicated three times. And, you know, and then there's the famous 8-year long trial in front of the Inquisition.
Yeah, where he doesn't back down at all from the points that are important to him. What people don't realize is that he's like, yeah, fine, you can have that. I'll rescind that. But he gets to that sort of V for Vendetta inch, which is like, no, I'm not budging off this.
Right, and that's the other weird thing, is that when he was in front of the Venetian Inquisition, he is willing to just throw it all over. He says, sure, whatever I've done wrong, whatever objections you have, I regret them, and I will do penance for them, and, you know, I will go and sin no more. But you kind of get the feeling that after 8 years of living in a dungeon with other heretics and malcontents and cranks, who were actually the supplementary witnesses against him in the Roman trial, you know, and they heard him swearing and blaspheming and doing all sorts of things, which is the peculiar thing about the blasphemy charges are that depending on what city you were in Italy at the time, you know, certain things were just common parlance and were not at all shocking, including, you know, in the highest levels of the church. Like, people would say, you know, pig god and you know, screw the Madonna and all of these things as just sort of expostulations in daily life, including the Pope, you know. So, but in other places, if you said the wrong one, you were in quite a bit of trouble. And he was already in quite a bit of trouble.
And 8 years having to have effectively the same argument with people you think are idiots, you'd end up longing for the flames. You'd just be like, I can't have this conversation with you again.
Yes, exactly. So, I mean, he's fighting with Cardinal Robert Bellarmine, who is he's an interesting figure because this was kind of the big trial where he made his bones right after he became a cardinal. And this was like his big shot as a prosecutor. So, yeah, he did this. And then many years later, he sort of soft-pedaled the Galileo affair, right, and sort of warned Galileo, now, you don't want to think that Bruno did. Right? You're issues which are much smaller, and what you've been accused of is much, much less serious than what Bruno was accused of. So, you know, maybe you just don't kick up as many waves. But Galileo was also a fairly difficult human being.
The Galileo, I mean, he managed that slightly better, but the heresy is less horrifying to the totality of church doctrine than Bruno's one, which we'll obviously come onto. It's interesting. I think you're right. I like that idea of the sort of, it's kind of like a district attorney situation where you got to make your mark with this really big trial. But I think, of all the people the church burned, Bruno scared them the most, because it was a kind of unrepentance from someone who was brilliant. He was the most evil man who ever lived up until about the 1790s, which is not bad. I mean, you know, Crowley only had that for a few years. Bruno had it for a couple of centuries. And even now, they're still kind of squeamish about, do we apologize for burning Giordano Bruno? I think he really put the wind up them, because this was a moment where it's like, goodness, could we be wrong about the whole thing?
Right. Well, the other part of it is that they really did not like the fact that he was a priest who had been doing this stuff. So they got very mad when it was one of their own. Right. If it had just been some guy from, you know, the Netherlands or whatever, they probably would have still killed him. But, you know, they wouldn't have really gone after him hammer and tongs and trying to get him extradited from Venice to Rome. They would have, you know, let the Venetians have him, and kind of, he'd have to live quietly.
Yeah, which, funnily enough, in that macro sense, we're kind of jumping around the timeline here, so we'll come back to this. I think that is a bit more evidence. I mean, one, it shows that their system could potentially be flawed, but I also think there's evidence of that hermetic political meddling that they were a bit scared of, because of the implications of what the hermetic underground prior to Bruno was trying to do to the sort of structures of kingship and the church and the elevation of common men and crucially women, ideas like universal education and all this. So I think they were a bit scared of it's kind of circumstantial evidence towards this idea that he was a spy for himself. He was a spy for essentially attempting to collapse the physical manifestations of that sort of sometimes Aristotelian, sometimes Neoplatonic harmonic universe that he found so absurd.
Yes.
Yeah, which we'll get onto. The text in question is, I mean, this, we went all the way to his death. The text in question that you have translated, De Umbris Idearum, was from kind of earlier on in his career. That was when he was in France.
Right. So after he flees Italy, because he's got essentially pornographic literature, as you put it, although I don't know how pornographic Erasmus is, but he also may have had
porn in Italy.
Yeah, but he may have also been reading other more heavy-duty tomes. There's some suggestion by some quarters that he had grimoires stuck down the toilet, or that they otherwise found them there. But anyway, he was a master of the art of memory, and we'll get to what that's all about in a little bit. But he basically flees from Italy shortly after having delivered a demonstration of the art of memory in front of the Pope. The Pope is thrilled, but then there are rumors that he's going to be arrested when he gets back to the convent. So he makes his way up to France, takes a master's degree in Toulouse, and then goes to the court of Henri III, King of France, presents him with this book, De Umbris Idearum, which is the first of his surviving books on the art of memory. And Henri is impressed by this, and then Bruno gives him a demonstration of the art of memory, and he says, oh my gosh, this is the most fantastic thing ever, but is it magic or is it just art and skill? And he says, well, okay, here's how it's really done. And proves to his satisfaction that he is just doing something that is natural art.
Well, the quote is, it's an example of the art.
Yes.
When Henri III asks, is this magic? He's like, it's an example of art. And again, I think, because we come back to the sort of straw man magic science difference, he is perpetrating magic on the King of France by giving him a system that is actually, constructions of memory palaces using the names of planets and classical gods and things from mythology. So he's kind of being a bit tricksy there, if you ask me. He's like, this is not a book of magic in the sense that you will learn magic. I am perpetrating magic on you.
Yeah, so it's a very interesting book because in one sense you can look at it and you say this is one where he sort of threw a bit of everything in. So there's a poetic introduction. There's, this florilegium of really fancy language where he praises, both his patrons at the court and Henri III himself. And then he has two sections, one of which is kind of thought of as the theoretical basis for the art of memory, but also is a heavily hermetic and Neoplatonic thesis. And then he has a second part, which is setting up all of these elaborate memory palaces using both characters from Ovid's Metamorphoses, but also all of the zodiac and the decans and the planets and other really kind of mystical and magical images. Now, it's difficult to tell for certain whether he's doing magic in the book itself or whether he is kind of pushing the image that he's a magician, right, in the way that, like, a carnival barker will push it, or like a fortune teller will push it. So you put stars and moons and planets all over the outside of your, on the outside of your hat and on your wagon, and people will go, ooh, that's really cool. Because these people were interested in the same things in the same ways that people today are. But also, he has passages in there where he says, these techniques will work in accordance with nature, alongside nature, or if need be, against nature. And this is kind of a dog whistle for the people who are in the know, because essentially what he means by against nature is that you can set up images to make the world be as you would like it to be. And you can manipulate people and creatures and the natural world in ways that are not in accordance with nature. It's not the way that they are now.
Yeah. And so if you write that in a book and give it to the King of France as a textbook, really, as a thing like here are some lessons for you, Your Majesty, and you call it an example of the art, for me, where, and we'll have to have this discussion now so I don't sound crazy, that is an example of Bruno's magic. Like, he was doing that, what he just said, not necessarily working against nature, but he was using these images by kind of putting them in the mind of the king. That's what I think he means by it's an example of the art. Well, the king was asking, is this a grimoire? Which it isn't. But he says it's an example of the art. It's like, this is my spell on you, but I'm not actually going to say it that way because at least at the time he had some sense of self-preservation. Now, for me, let's talk about the magic science thing, because I was actually at a sort of Dame Francis retrospective in London a couple of months ago. And what frustrates me is the question comes up very often, and it's the sort of eternal Brunology question. Did he even do magic? As in, bro, do you even lift? And it's strawman because he didn't at all do magic in the way a contemporary like Robert Flood did, because he thought that model was and is moronic of this kind of even depending on how you felt about the Copernican model, the Robert Flood system of this kind of emanatory rays of planets coming down into the microcosm of man in the Earth in the middle was completely counter to Bruno's cosmology. He was one of them. He's that classic everybody stupid but me. He thought they were stupid. He thought that whole idea was stupid. So the suggestion that Bruno was a magician in the Agrippan or Robert Flood sense is not correct. But if you live in a pantheist universe where, you know, you've read Michael Sellis and you actually can tell the difference between the spirits and demons that you've personally said have encountered them. I mean, he writes in On Magic that spirits in the graveyard were throwing rocks at him as he walked through and they exploded around his head. He's got that, and he has this profound kind of mental technology. For me, as, you know, magicians in the 21st century, he's doing magic. He's just not doing that kind of Robert Flood magic.
Right. Well, the way that I usually look at it is that a lot of Bruno's magic collapses to be early psychology.
Yeah.
In the way that a lot of alchemy turns into kind of early chemistry. Or maybe not. But he... So if you look in On Magic, he says there are 9 different primary definitions of magic, ranging from, you know, the kind of stupid things that desperate people do where they make a deal with the devil. There are other ones that people talk about magic as being the stuff that conjurers and people in, you know, down at the fair do, where they're making balls disappear underneath cups. And then you range upward to whatever it was that the priests of the old pagan days were doing, right, where they were communicating with the eminent spirits of the world. So, you know, the classical gods, either Greek or Egyptian. And then he gets up to philosophy, which is kind of knowing how the world works, right? And he says, you know, this is actually the highest and best definition, which is you should know how the world works. And if you do that, then you can do whatever you like. And so in one sense, he always claims to be a philosopher as a defense, right? He says, I'm not doing that magical stuff over here. But also he was saying this is the sort of the best thing to be. Is to be wise, is to know how things function. And we can talk a little bit, if you want, about his ideas about creation of bonds. So he was a big fan of the concept that love basically makes the world go round. And more broadly, he took that to mean attraction. So when he does his cosmological work, he says the thing that keeps the planets circling around the sun is that they are attracted to it by bonds of love. They feel affectionate toward it. And he says all of the emotions are actually ones that can be reduced to love in the end. He says even hate is just a different form of love. Which is a kind of, in one sense, is warm and fuzzy, but is also a very profound thing to say.
It is. He's in his kind of role of, or in his kind of belief that everyone's stupid but him, that wasn't just his contemporaries. That was actually the classical authors that he'd read as well. And he would pick pieces from them and consider the rest. I mean, I know he has the sort of lurid ideas. And it, I mean, he sort of triggered some of these ideas by saying pretty much precisely this in Oxford. But he didn't necessarily want a return to what he viewed as the sort of Egyptian worldview, because he considered them debased as well. He says they worshipped onions. but what he wanted was the pieces that were behind it. He felt that they had a debased or declined or an incomplete story of his cosmology as well. And when he talks about love, you're right, it's on one level it's warm and fuzzy, but he would have encountered ideas like agape from his readings, so that love has a very specific philosophical, which is the same thing as scientific at the time, meaning.
Yes. And he, you know, he talks about generating bonds of various sorts. One interpretation of that was something that was written by Ion Kulianu, who was a professor at the University of Chicago, who was murdered back in the late 80s, early 90s. And
very suspiciously.
Yes, very suspiciously. I had been working with a woman who wrote an entire script about it and who is now working on a feature film, and we were also going to do a documentary on it.
Very cool. Out of This World is on my bookshelf right now. I love it.
Yes, and so that all came out of the Bruno stuff. So she called me because of the Bruno books. But one of his ideas was that essentially what Bruno is trying to do in these magical essays in the modern world looks like advertising and marketing. So he's building up associations, which are the bonds that he's talking about. And he says, one of the things that he says is you either have to be completely neutral or you have to be totally consumed and you have to be in total harmony with the person that you're trying to work the bond on. So, you know, as you will probably know, that's the idea of that is that those are the two states of meditative absorption. So in one, you have complete equanimity, and in the other one, you have complete identification with, you know, other people and with the world itself.
Yeah, absolutely. This is, I mean, you said you read comics, so you'd be familiar with Grant Morrison's idea that The Invisibles was a hypersigil. So that he wrote this book and lived parts of it, and then as a result, his life actually became intertwined, particularly with the character of King Mobbs. He started to dress like King Mob and then had his lung collapse, which is the same thing that happened in his book subsequently. And when you look at Bruno's version of magic, he's essentially, because matter was divine for him, because the Neoplatonic model was just wrong for him, if you are attempting to, build an improved divine landscape, if you're actually attempting to make the world look like how he thought it ran, you do, where Giordano says advertising, it's the same thing as giving the King of France all these potent symbols, which he knew worked better than others. Like the more vivid the symbol, the more it worked. So you actually kind of see him in his entire life sort of doing this to the physical, to matter, to having these books out there and using these images and elevating them into consciousness. He's actually trying to do the thing that he would do or he would teach in life. And I find that's for me where I think the sort of embassy affair is incorrect. Bruno was a spy for Bruno. He's trying to change the world using these techniques that he's writing about. And it gets to a very, for me anyway, my read of it, it gets to a very Grant Morrison hypersigil level where you end up bringing these ideas into the physical, which is so important to him. And we'll get to that cosmology in a sec, but that's kind of a variant on what sort of Giordano was talking about for me.
Yes, so he let's go back. We had left him with the King of France.
Yeah, well, let's talk about the book, because...
Okay, let's talk about the book. So,
first of all... was this the first one you translated? Because, like, the thing with Bruno's texts is, at the moment anyway, they're all over the place, and they certainly need to be systematized and could have kind of made bio available to the modern world. They're a mess. And are you going sort of sequentially through his major works with starting with the Umbris Idearum, or was there a particular reason why you thought, actually, I'm gonna get a nice, clean version of this out there for people?
So the basic motivation behind getting it translated myself was that I had called around and tried to get other people who were classicists or Renaissance experts or whoever to translate the thing, and they all came back and said, "No, I'm terribly busy, couldn't be bothered." And I said, "Well, surely there is some translation of this thing out there somewhere." And they said, "No, no one has done it in 400 plus years." And I said, "Well, that's no good." And so I went on all of these memory fora, and, you know, bulletin boards and all kinds of things, and found that there were tons and tons of other people who were looking for this particular book. So I said, "Okay, well, look, if you say someone must surely do this enough times, eventually you have to volunteer to do that thing." Right? And so I started translating it and did not really speak Latin when I started. Did not read Latin, I had some scientific Latin, some legal Latin, something on that level, but, you know, kind of did this the slow and painful way with, you know, a dictionary on my lap and going through. And if you don't know five words in the first sentence, you look up five words. And if you don't know the four words in the next sentence, you look up four words. And by the way, this method has evidently offended one or two people who, you know, have written terrible reviews on Amazon and who have sent me emails and who have done other things, because they were just dreadfully offended that the translation was not done in a way that was pleasing to them.
No good deed goes unpunished, Scott.
Right. And so, anyway, so it took me a while to crawl through the entirety of this manuscript, because Bruno's Latin is sort of in three modes, and one of them is sort of a plain-speaking didactic mode, where he's very vivid and very bright and very, very lively, but he's understandable. There's another one where he gets very, very terse, and so he'll just say one word or two words that really kind of expand in English into an entire sentence or paragraph. And then he's got a third one, which is where he really cuts loose with the oratory, and you have to go searching for the lone verb in four or five lines of a sentence, right?
And it's never. Do you think he's a bit manic, or do you think he was just a really diverse writer? Because he certainly liked different forms.
I would not be surprised if he was a little bit bipolar.
Mm.
You know, he has that same, like you mentioned, Grant Morrison, where he just has this exuberance at times, but then also there are discernible times where he seems very down, very depressed, very closed off. But I don't know. It's hard enough to make a diagnosis on somebody who's alive right now,
mm-hmm.
Much less someone from 400 years ago. But my guess is that, yeah, he has that style. He has some of the signs, the flight of ideas, the grandiosity, just the black and white views of life that alternate. So, you know, one day everybody is wonderful and, you know, the birds are singing and heaven, you know, God is in heaven. And the next day it's a disaster and life is terrible and you people are all fools. And, you know, and he holds views in sort of rapid succession.
Which is one of the reasons you get a multiplicity of Brunos. You can find, right. You can find him saying something that, I mean, I think the consensus is that he wasn't a Neoplatonist. He certainly used some of their ideas and images, but you could probably find one or two things he wrote that's like, see, he was a Neoplatonist. And
yes.
He's quite fluid in that way. I mean, the best cosmologists are all damaged and all sort of fluid, because once someone's died, you kind of have a chunk of time stream where they're working something out over several decades. So it's very difficult to, especially the state of the text at the moment, it's very difficult to get, if even such a thing exists, and I don't think it does, a coherent exegesis of the Brunosphere.
Yes. And so in doing that first book, I had at first tried to get it published through some of the larger Renaissance library series that are out there right now, but unfortunately most of the money for that particular segment of the Renaissance was supported by the Italian government, and this was just after the big financial crash. So all of those grants got pulled. And then there was a death in one of the editors died, and then all sorts of other things. So I ended up doing the self-publishing route, or the independent publishing route, which has turned out to be a really fantastic way to do it, because I can offer the book relatively inexpensively. I can revise it as needed if there are flaws found in it. I can get it to a large number of people, and it has sold consistently literally every day since I published it 3 or 4 years ago, which is sort of remarkable for, a 400-year-old book on esoteric memory techniques.
And a messy one. Like, as you say, it's broken into pieces. He's got this sort of blowing smoke up the king at the beginning, and then, he switches into his, I'm going to do a play now, and then there's just some lists in it. You know, it's actually,
right.
It's a messy book.
It's a messy book. It's kind of a delightfully messy book.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, you know, I always think of sort of Shakespeare as being one of those people who puts a lot of stuff into his works. So there's, you know, there's always something to look at or something interesting that someone has just said, even if it doesn't have to do with the main plot or it isn't really developing a character. It's just kind of a nice twinkly little bit that can be, you know, that can be appreciated as it goes past. And in the same way, Bruno has a lot of stuff in there, some of which is useful and some of which is not. The people who read it for a basic intro to how to do the memory palace or method of loci technique are going to be disappointed because it is very elaborate, it's very big, and it's not really an instruction manual. It is it's like a cathedral stuffed inside of a little book.
Yeah. Well, that's a very good thing to say, because people who are listening who haven't read the book yet will hopefully pick it up. So let's give the audio commentary to it. Scott, what is a top-line version of Bruno's kind of memory tech?
So the basic idea is of the memory palace is that you are going to use the wiring that you have inside your head, which is designed for making your way through the world accurately, and you're going to take advantage of the fact that you're really good at memorizing A, things that are emotionally important to you, and B, things that are visually arrayed in different patterns. So the technique was originally developed back in the classical world by either poets or people who were doing legal cases or whatever. And there's a set of essential rules for how you set these things up. So what you do is you convert every word or everything that you are trying to remember into an image or combination of images. And these images should be as vivid as possible in your mind. And they should also be ones that provoke a strong emotion for you, whether that is they should be frightening or horrifying or funny or sexual or heroic or anything else. So there was one bishop in the Middle Ages who did all of his sermons using the memory palace technique and would do a series of pornographic images in his head while he was preaching the gospel. And so You then take these images and you arrange them around a memory of a physical building, usually. And you have a particular order that you go through that building. And as you go through, you note each of the images. And when you want to remember something, you just imagine yourself walking through that building again in the same order, and you'll be able to pick up those same images again. There are other sort of subsidiary rules, like you should have a well-lighted, all of the places should be well-lighted. You shouldn't have to walk too far, but you also shouldn't have everything jammed together. You have rules like you shouldn't put a red object on a red background because you'll tend to forget it, which is it's a very interesting rule because it's one of the proofs that you have that he isn't just BSing.
Yeah.
This is actually a psychological thing, and it's something that you would not know if you were just writing down what someone else was experiencing. You actually had to have done that on at least one occasion and been like, wow, you know, where did I put that thing?
Yeah, he definitely walked his talk with this stuff. I mean, the other one for me, the indicator is that, which is where he gets to the list, and it's a little bit trying to sneak the magic in, and it's a little bit correct, which is the more emotionally potent the images, you know, sexually or culturally, the better they work. So in that almost chaos magic sense, if you have the choice between Apollo and Superman, which one contains the most sort of potency or resonance, and which can contain the most idea, you can see him sort of, you can see him testing different objects, you know what I mean? Like he's going, okay, right. Well, if I don't want to use Venus, I'll just try some chick. And I go, nope, Venus works better, we'll stick with that.
Right. And so now one of the other interesting things that he does in this particular book is that he mentions that you can actually use the same images for backgrounds as you can for the front-grounded images or the things that you're attaching to each location. So in modern times, you can also do things which are not physical houses. You can do memory palaces that are movies. So if you happen to have seen Star Wars or The Godfather a huge number of times, you can insert your memory images into those particular scenes because you know the order in which things happen, right? You can do it with, like I said, Shakespeare's plays. So if you know Romeo and Juliet, you know the plot line of that, you know all the scenes for that, then you can use Romeo and Juliet's setting and the scenes that are going on in the background, and you can put your images in the front of them.
Yeah. You know, I was thinking before this talk, I'm kind of between memory palaces myself. I had one that was a hotel I would, like a resort I would go to every year as a kid, which I'd know inside out. So it's a kind of 1980s version of this hotel in Fiji, but a little bit more like leaves strewn around. It's sort of abandoned, pleasant. I tried to use it because as I was preparing for this conversation, I haven't used it for a while. It's not as good anymore. But what occurred to me, the film one is interesting. I would like to see, I don't want to do it because it'll mess with my use of tarot, but I would like to see someone try to memorize a predefined amount of things using tarot cards. If you're familiar with it, it's kind of like the movie. If you can go from the Fool all the way to the end of the court cards as a sequence, it's sort of like the movie.
Right. And those images tend to be very strong images. You know, they're very evocative images. People have found them to be memorable and interesting and, you know, worth reproducing and varying in their own artistic style, you know, for hundreds of years.
Did you, when you were translating, did you ever crack at it?
I don't use the memory palace technique in the way that Bruno uses it. I do use the underlying visualization techniques, which nevertheless takes a long time to get up to speed on. So if you're used to, for comparison, like think of meditation, which you can basically get the hang of in 10 minutes or 20 minutes, and you're really going within a week. If you're trying to do this kind of elaborate visualization and intense visualization, Bruno himself and the other authors say it takes maybe 3 to 6 months. And that's if you're really good at it to begin with. So it takes a long time to really juice up the visuals. But yeah, I use it for other things. So I will visualize problems, or I will visualize, you know, architectural diagrams or strategic situations or, you know, product ideas or other things that I'm working on in my other daily life. I also do a technique sometimes that Bruno describes where you will have authors or other people, you will visualize them actually talking to you and narrating their own work.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So, or you can also do fictional characters. So both, I think Neil Gaiman has done it. Hilary Mantel mentions that she did it for her book, The Giant O'Brien, where she put out a chair and had a visualization of the giant walking in and sitting down and telling the story. And she just took dictation.
That's interesting. It's interesting, especially as we sort of harken back to what you're saying, that Bruno's system is essentially a, in your interpretation of it, an early form of psychology.
Yes.
What I found out at this, which I didn't realize, I mean, I knew, everyone knows that he had some influence on people like Coleridge, and so that crew was very big on their drug-induced imaginal wanderings, which is fine and good. But I didn't realize that basically all the 19th century German philosophers had the books of Bruno that they could get at the time in their studies. So when you're talking about psychology, that essentially makes him an accidental grandfather of Jung, because Jung's ideas of the unconscious come from those 19th century Central European philosophers who were all reading Bruno. And here we have this, burned Italian friar doing, working out images in the mind and what they can do. And I find that very interesting, that he's kind of an accidental grandfather of Jung.
Yes, and also the idea of the archetypes, because the big images that are supposed to sit at the top of the food chain are the big Platonic ideals, right? So whether that is, you know, your images of Venus or whatever it may be, those things which are not the shadows but are the ideas themselves. So he talks about a lot of these things as being intermediate forms. So these are the derivative forms for what are the Platonic ideals of whatever. And those Platonic ideals then connect to the idea of the archetypes.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, this is quite a neat segue into the last piece I want to talk about, because I get asked this a bit, is, so what was, let's take a stab at it, what was Bruno's cosmology? Here is someone who found matter to be divine. And so he's been, I think, kind of misappropriated by materialists and atheists, because he was only an atheist in the 17th century definition of the word, rather than the Richard Dawkins definition of the word. But it's a fascinating thing that he didn't think the universe ran Neoplatonically, but there is a hierarchy of potency in the images that work in the mind. So that's the bit that I think throws people. But Scott, in your opinion, how did Bruno see the universe?
Okay, so in the astronomical sense, he's one of the people who followed Copernicus. So he reads Copernicus, decides that, in fact, yes, the solar system is heliocentric, right? The traditional way of looking at it was that it was probably the Earth that was in the middle, and we knew that what was heavy sank and what was light rose, and so they thought these are the two opposing forces in the universe. And then outside of the Earth, there are concentric spheres of what's essentially crystal of some kind that have the planets embedded in them. And the planets rotate around the Earth. And then the outermost sphere is a sphere of fixed stars. And beyond that is essentially God. And he said, no, this is not correct. The Earth is not the center of the universe. It's the sun. All of the planets rotate around the sun. Those stars up there are not fixed stars. They are not nailed up to the ceiling. And he literally says, you know, they are neither nailed nor glued to the roof of a small cupola. You know, he says, the universe is infinitely large. And he says, if you tried to go to the edge of it, and you threw a rock off, you would then have that, wherever that rock fell would be the edge, and then you keep going, and it goes on forever. And so he says, everything is infinite. All of those stars up there are suns and planets like our own. He doesn't call them planets, he calls them Earths.
That's so, the heresy. That's the bit. That's where he went further than Copernicus, because Copernicus moving the solar system around doesn't change the biblical status of man, whereas Bruno goes out of his way to change the biblical status of man by elevating everything from a blade of grass to the same, and that is that gets you on the pyre.
Yeah. Well, the interesting part about it is that. So he has this vision of infinity, and he says also, like, you think you're the center of the universe, and whoever's standing up there is also thinking the same thing about themselves, which is a kind of interesting perceptual insight, right? That you think you're the middle because you're standing on a rotating globe, and it's rotating around its own center and then around the sun, and this gives you the illusion that everything is, you know, centered on you. But wherever you stand in the universe, you would have the same illusion. And he also does away with the force of levity or lightness. And he says, you know, it's all really just, he says, it's not really gravity either. It's, again, this force of affection. And he says, so if you took a particle from the Earth and you put it really close to Mars or wherever, it would fall to Mars. If you took a piece of the moon and you brought it close to the Earth, it would fall to Earth. And he says, that's not anything to do with gravity. That's just, it. Everything goes toward the kind of thing that it naturally is. And he still, at that point, had, you know, four-element theory of earth, air, fire, water. And he thought that water was the heaviest element, and that the earth was filled with rivers of water that were underground and would occasionally shoot up. And
funnily enough, that's another thing that he didn't get completely wrong. There are, we found the other year, you know, giant underground oceans.
Right, but he thought that they went all the way through like veins of the earth, and the same thing with fire. And he thought that the sun itself was basically a huge forest that had been on fire for many years. And that the other planets were bright and reflective because we were looking at sunshine bouncing off of water. And he says, if you've ever noticed, you go up to a mountain and look down at a lake, it looks like it's just blazing with light, you know, if you do it during the daytime. And he says, it's the same way over there. Now,
the metaphysical heresy there, of course, is that he made them out of the same stuff.
So yes.
He definitively says that those stars are the same as our sun, and that they are made of the same thing. Everything is made of... He found matter divine. So when we talk about matter, we need to jump back to the 1500s and realize that their version of matter is, again, not what you'd find from materialists. But that's the heresy, because from sort of Dionysius the Areopagite on, the stuff above the earth was closer to heaven, made of a different thing, and more godly. And he's like, nope. The entire universe is made out of the same thing. And that is, again, that gets you on the pyre. And it's very interesting.
Well, it doesn't all by itself. There were two different ways to approach it. So in one sense, you could say with perfect safety that I have conjectured that perhaps these other things are like Earth. They are, that I think they might be like the material made here. Lots of people actually did that. So, you know, Christoph Clavius says it, Galileo says it. But what they get really terribly upset at is if you don't say, you know, either this is a mathematical conjecture, or if you have evidence, then yes, they will listen to you and you don't go on the pyre. But what happens if you present conjecture as truth is they get very, very upset with you. And you do go on the pyre, or you risk the pyre.
If it runs counter, because the implications of his cosmology, which he doubles down on wherever possible, is it just kind of cuts the legs out underneath the role of man in the universe and the role of the church as a result of man's role in the universe. Because, I mean, he goes out of his way to say we're like...
Yeah, he really gets in trouble because of the theological
theological implications. Yes, right. Because he basically says everything is the same. Actually, I've got a quote here. But we know there is an infinite field, a containing space which embraces and interpenetrates the whole. We'll talk about that in a sec. That's kind of his love consciousness field. It is an infinity of bodies similar to our own. No one of these, more than another, is the center of the universe. So he's cosmologically putting it together, and then he goes like trees and matter and grass are the same thing as us. And that is not what the Bible says about man put on the earth and about, you know, original sin and the role of man in the universe. He's like, no, we're like a tree or a planet or a star. We're all the one stuff.
Right. And he also gets in trouble because he does several things like deny the divine Christ. Mm-hmm. you know, which is going to get you in trouble with the Catholic Church.
That's kind of their whole deal.
Right. And then, you know, in a sense, you get the impression that part of why he does that is because he's what would now be called a Unitarian, so or a non-Trinitarian, at any rate. And that he takes that position in part because he is mathematically minded in the way that Newton also flirted with the idea. He had a number of other very particular heresies, some of which were along the same lines, but also he had ones that you get the feeling he just took because, again, he was a really irascible, prickly human being who thought that he was smarter than everyone else.
And when right. compared to the worldview being promulgated by the church, like, it's a better worldview. It is more accurate. So in that respect, he was smarter. And, yeah.
So, anyway, so that's the second book that I translated was On the Infinite, which is one of his six books in Italian. And that one I did because the Cosmos series was doing a segment on him. And, you know, it seemed like an interesting one. And also it was the only one of the six books which hadn't been recently translated. And the existing translation, while very good, was written in something like Shakespearean English. So there was a lot of thee-ing and thou-ing and, you know, kind of anachronistic language in it, when in fact the Italian is very, very modern.
Why did he write the six Italian dialogues in London? Like, why did he switch languages?
I don't know.
I'm just going to jump in because this is the second half of that question. I'm inclined to agree with, say, Hilary Garty that those six dialogues, the London Italian dialogues, are essentially pieces of one project, which I want to see if you agree with, but then why? Why did he switch to Italian when he was in London?
You know, part of it was, I think he was just part of an expat community that was in London. So he was very good friends with John Florio. And Italian was seen as kind of a sophisticated language in some ways, or kind of a sexy language, even back then. So people would learn it alongside Latin, but they would use the Italian to woo women. They would do, you know, they used it to enhance their own poetry. But, you know, I think some of it was that he was homesick. I think some of it was he did want to do more kind of pop science books, almost.
Yeah, that I think it makes him, it's cool. Italian is still cool, but the prominence of the language in the culture, as you sort of see expressed for reasons that are a bit suspicious in Shakespeare, means that you're writing in the cool language, but also in a political climate that is not. Like, Latin belongs to the church and officialdom. He wrote for a king in Latin. But when he's writing in London, in the London of Elizabeth, this is a whole new world. And this is where I think Hilary Mantel's correct that these six Italian dialogues hang together, because he ends it with the story of those...
Hilary Gotti.
Gotti, sorry, yeah. We were just talking about Mantel, yeah. Because he ends it with those nine blind Italian philosophers who are cured of their blindness by a cipher for Elizabeth on the banks of the Thames. So he's got this kind of... I think he saw, even though he didn't... His model didn't really allow for kingship to be a thing. The sort of English Renaissance that was emerging was this opportunity for all the Hermeticists to see a world that wasn't structured in the Holy Roman Imperial kind of continental king sense. She was a woman for a start. She wasn't Catholic. And there was this vibrant opportunity. If anywhere was going to let Bruno's world come to life, it was kind of there. And I think it's interesting that it's London and it's Italian dialogues, and it ends with, I mean, he always blew smoke up Royal's butts, but it ends with this kind of very almost alchemical image of nine Italian philosophers being cured of their blindness on the Thames.
Yes. The interesting thing is that he did also write a lot of these ideas in the Latin works, and those were very formal and very kind of designed for the intelligentsia and for the nobility and the church. But, you know, he did also enjoy, you know, writing for the common people, and it's certainly clear that he writes more entertainingly in the Italian. You know, he's lively and he's funny, and he, you know, in his early life he wrote a play called The Candle Bearer that's just this, you know, darkly funny thing about basically street level life in Naples.
And I think it also has some of the more, you're right, he writes better in Italian, because I think it has some of the, he was obviously on an up day when he wrote these things, some of the sort of nicer descriptions of how he sees the world, and you get that kind of love, spirit, pantheism thing in that, and even to an extent, he's funnier in Ash Wednesday, but you kind of get that liveliness there as well.
Yeah. So anyway, that's the second book, is On the Infinite. The third one that I did was a collection of his works commenting on the great art of Ramon Llull, who was a 13th century Catalan mystic, who basically went up a mountain, had a vision of God, who told him to go write the greatest book in the world and go convert the heathens. Meaning the Moors of North Africa and the Jews. And his first attempts at doing these conversions were unsurprisingly not successful. So the Lullian system is that you should try to reduce everything to stuff that everyone can agree with, right? Very basic propositions like, is God good? And then try and work your way up to there, and then eventually do a right turn and say, well, and that's why you should all convert to the Catholic Church.
Right. Yeah. But funny enough, Lull was one of the influences on De Umbris Idearum, in the sense that he's kind of picked up some Aquinas and other things that he'd encountered in, you know, as a friar. It's interesting the influences he's had. And what I think interests me about Bruno's fascination with Lull is that Lull was on his own Blues Brothers mission to transform the world. So for Bruno, that's kind of what I think his game plan was as well. Obviously not to convert them to Catholicism, but here is someone who is like, okay, can one person completely change the worldview of a planet?
Right. And so the interesting things about the great art of Ramon Llull are that, one, he uses something which is called a volvel, which is a little paper machine, and you may even have used these, where you stick several circles of paper together with something written around the edges, and then you can rotate them independently and line up the different pieces of them. And sometimes you'll see them in games, or they'll be used for, enciphering things. But Lull used them as a logical system. Bruno uses them in his memory systems. If we were to do it today, we would probably just do a table or a grid rather than a circle. But the circle has certain religious or mystical symbolism that both of them really, really liked. So it represents, among other things, the year and the horizon and the human soul, right? Because it was the perfect shape. And also they were kind of fascinated with the fact that, you know, you went all the way around and you ended up back at the beginning. And then the other thing that Lull's system does for Bruno is that it allows him to take the art of memory, which is retrospective, and convert it into a prospective tool. So if you use Lull's logical system, you can formulate new propositions, you can manipulate whatever it is that you're using for images. So Lull used letters, but Bruno used the actual memory images, recombined them, and then looked at what he had ended up with and said, oh, is this something that we can use? Again, like we talked about early in the podcast, he said you can use these to basically emulate nature or work with nature, and you can also use it to provide an alternative to nature or work against nature.
Yeah.
Right.
All right, so this one's the challenging moving question, and I think it's a bit of a Venn diagram, but was he a monist? Was he a pantheist? Was he a not very good panentheist? What word describes, you know, at least 80% of Bruno?
Yes, he was all three of those.
Yeah, this is the trouble.
You know, and I'm not even sure that he knew.
He was a Brunoist.
Right. What he, like, if you look at the images that he has in his cosmological work, what he really likes is, again, putting a lot of stuff in. So he likes this image of there being an infinite number of planets, of suns, of whatever it is, of images, anything, in infinite variety and combination. And, like, he really loves that exuberant vision of a never-ending world, right, which is as large as possible and as encompassing as possible. But also being a complex unity. Right? And one of the alternative ideas that he fought against was the Aristotelian thing, which said, you know, if it were infinite, it would be, you know, it would all have to be full, and therefore it would all collapse, because it would be of infinite weight and it would collapse into nothing. And he says, well, no, you can also have not just a continuous infinity, but a discontinuous one, where different things are happening and what he called vicissitudes are occurring. So things are changing back and forth, they're moving around, they're transmutating, they're growing, they're dying, and all of this is always happening. Yeah. So that was kind of his big mystical vision, was like, I want it all, and I want it all to be happening, and I want, you know, everything to be going on all the time, all at once.
Forever.
Forever. Yeah. But that's all one thing.
Yeah. It's really nice. I mean, it's a lot more, it's optimistic. So we, again, got him on an up day. It's quite positive, and it kind of has transmutation of the soul and mind on some days, and you know, he's got spirits and demons in there, and he switches to this. Yeah, it's this amazing, exciting sort of never-ending chaotic universe, which he thought, and again, he ends up with a reasonably good conception of God as a result, which is, well, this is the only thing an infinite being can do or be. That's kind of his logic, and I find it it's very accommodating.
Yes, he has that image where he says, you know, which would be better for an all-powerful, all-knowing God? Would, you know, a little toy universe like you've described, or one that is, you know, never-ending and is also, you know, contains everything? You know, and he says, you be the judge. Which would you rather have? Which is the bigger one?
And it was that confidence, because we'll close it here, I think, but it was that confidence when he was being taken to the pyre, whether he said this or not, he probably did, because it sounds like him, is that he basically tells the people who are going to burn him, you're more scared about what's going to happen than I am. His universe didn't have hell or heaven. theirs did. He's like, I'm sweet. Burn me up.
Right, I'm going to go become someone else now.
Yeah. Well, this has been obviously fascinating, Scott. So for people who want to know more, and obviously everyone does, it's Bruno, where do they go to find out more? And also recommendation for people who are Brunophytes. I can go on and on with this. Anything that ends with an O, you can plug anything into it. What's the best book for people to start on?
Okay, the best book for people to start on is probably Francis Yates's Art of Memory. It is not necessarily the most accurate or most neutral version of Bruno, but it's the one that has got the most people excited over the years and has got the most people looking for more. If you are looking for a really well done, kind of what I would consider neutral or central version of Bruno, you should look at Ingrid Roland's Giordano Bruno, Philosopher Heretic. It's really well done and draws on most of the other major biographies. Likewise, Hilary Gotti has some fun things in her two books. If you're interested in kind of the scientific community at the time, Stephen Klukas has also written some nice things, both about Bruno and about some of the other hermeticists and various interesting people of that era.
And of Bruno's actual works, which one do you think is the kind of easiest to start on in that sense?
I would say you should start with one of the Italian dialogues, either On the Infinite or the Ash Wednesday Supper.
Yeah.
You know, most of the people, though, that I've run into are most interested in the memory works. So De Umbris is a good place to start for that, although it's a mind-blowingly complicated and difficult book to work through. There is one called The Song of Circe that is only currently available in limited edition in English. I have another one that's coming out this fall sometime, which is on one of his third or fourth memory books, which is called The 30 Seals,
where he
goes through what would now be called data structures that you can use to hang memory images on or to generate memory images. So he starts out with things like the tree, where you're supposed to take your main points and line them up along the trunk, and then on each branch you put your subsidiary points branching out from it. You know, he has other ones that are based on the sky or that are based on the zodiac or that are based on, you know, the planets or other things. Ones that are based on sculptors and painters and translators or, you know, physicians' gardens or other things.
So if people, I mean, how do they find you then if they want to, if that sounds interesting to them and they're like, no, I will have to make a note of that for the fall?
Sure. The easiest way to get the books themselves is to go to Amazon. The easiest way to reach me is I am at bottlerocketscience.net. That's my blog. I'm also at on Twitter as InfiniteMe.
And these will, of course, all be in the show notes.
This will all be in the show notes. And then also I have a podcast myself where I talk to various creative and interesting individuals. That is called Startup Geometry.
Nice one. Well, Scott, this has been fantastic. Always got time for a Bruno chat. Thank you very much, and thank you for your work.
It's been a pleasure.
So I think we can all agree that discussion was Brunissimo. As ever, I'd love to hear your thoughts and feedback. Head over to the blog, runesoup.com, or the RuneSoup Facebook page. Subscribe to the show in your favorite podcatcher or on YouTube. And seek me out on Twitter, where I am Gordon, GORDON_White, WHITE. Until next time.